Hi everyone, dear students, colleagues, pharma professionals, good day to all. I feel happy to meet you all through this online platform in sharing of knowledge. Before going to the slides, let me brief out the presentation. This presentation is an outline about the course Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics in the program Bachelor of Pharmacy for 6th semester students. So that this presentation would be helpful for the 6th semester students to be familiarizing about the course. So let's move on to the next slide. So the contents which are going to cover in this presentation are the scope and the learning objective, the course outcomes, the course outline, and description of syllabus unit wise, and finally the reference textbooks. This course has been included in the curriculum with the scope to impart knowledge and skills of biopharmaceutics and pharmacokinetics and their application in pharmaceutical development, design of dosage form, dosage regimen, and to overcome the problems encountered in the same. Let's move on to the next slide. Learning objectives. It is defined as the expected goal of the course in terms of demonstrable skills and knowledge that will be acquired by students as a result of instruction. So upon completion of the course, the student shall be able to meet up the following four objectives. The first objective is understand the basic concept in biopharmaceutics and pharmacokinetics and their significance. The second objective is use of plasma concentration time data profile to calculate the pharmacokinetic parameters to describe the kinetics of drug absorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion, and elimination. The third objective is to understand the concept of bioavailability and bioequivalence of drug products and their significance. The last objective of this course is to understand the various pharmacokinetic parameters and their significance and applications. Let's move on to the next slide. Course outcome. Course outcome is a measurable, observable, and specific statement that clearly indicates what a student should know and be able to do as a result of learning this course. Five course outcomes have been framed by keeping Bloom taxonomy in their hierarchy of remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating strategies. The CO1 is able to recite rudimentary theories in biopharmaceutics and pharmacokinetics. The second CO is the student is able to describe process of drug absorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination with respect to the pharmacokinetic data. The third CO is able to predict the effect of ADME and analyze its biological effect on the drug. Fourth CO is able to justify the by applying suitable compartment modeling and or model independent method in analyzing the pharmacokinetic parameters from the biological samples. The last CO is to determine the clinical significance of biological bioavailabilities and bioequivalence in designing new dosage form or dosage regimen. Let's move on to the next slide. So now let us discuss about the course outline. The total lecture hours for the course is 45. The course Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics. Both are parallel concepts in which they deal with the factors and rate process involved in ADME. So let us discuss about biopharmaceutics first and later about the pharmacokinetics. Biopharmaceutics is a science that examines the interrelationship of physicochemical properties of drug, the dosage form in which the drug is given, and the route of administration on the rate and extent of systemic drug absorption. The biopharmaceutics involves the following factors such as the stability of drug within the drug product, the release of drug from the drug product, the rate of dissolution or release of drug at the absorption site, and the site of absorption of the drug. So these are all the various aspects which covers in the biopharmaceutics. And now let us get information about the biopharmaceutics related aspects one by one as given in the syllabus as an outline. Absorption. So absorption is defined as a process of movement of drug from the site of administration to the systemic circulation. For example, upon administering a dosage form such as tablet or capsules on oral administration, the drug reaches the stomach, which is called as the site of administration. From there, the tablet will undergo disintegration, dissolution, followed by absorption through the gastric mucosa, thereby it reaches the blood. So this process of movement of drug from the stomach to the blood is called as absorption. And the next is about distribution. It is a process of movement of drug from one compartment to another compartment. That is, in absorption the drug reaches the blood. Now in distribution, the drug moves from blood to the extravascular tissue. Next is about elimination. So this elimination or excretion includes two stages. One is drug disposition or metabolism, and another is elimination. So the drug which reaches the tissue possesses the desired pharmacological activity and gets converted into an inactive metabolite which gets eliminated from the body through renal or non-renal excretion. And the next thing is bioavailability and bioequivalence. So bioavailability is defined as the rate and extent of drug which reaches the systemic circulation in unchanged form. And the bioequivalence is a property of drug substance in two or more identical dosage form reaching the systemic circulation at same relative rate and the same relevant extent. That is, this plasma concentration time profile will be identical with significant statistical differences. So that similarity in the plasma profile of two dosage form, that we call it as a bioequivalence. So these are the content which comes under the concept related to biopharmaceutics under this course. So these absorption, distribution, elimination, and what are the factors involved in it, that we'll be discussing in this topic. Let us discuss, I'll be detailing this one in the upcoming slides. And let's move on to the another aspect, pharmacokinetics. So this pharmacokinetics word has been derived from a Greek word, pharmakon is nothing but drug, and kinetikos is nothing but movement. That is the rate process involved in movement of drug, particularly in relation to absorption, distribution, metabolism and elimination. And students, you might be familiar about the concept as kinetics, which have been studied in physical pharmacy. It is zero order kinetics, first order kinetics, degradation, rate of degradation might have been studied about it. So similarly, here we can predict the order of kinetics of drug movement in various processes by which we can determine the AUC, Cmax, Tmax, T-half, KE and so on. So thereby we may come to know the onset of action of the drug from the dosage form, or else the maximum time at which the drug reaches the higher concentration, or the maximum concentration what it reaches during the complete dosage administration, or else the overall available bioavailable dose AUC that can be calculated. Also about the elimination, what is the time duration that a drug to get completely eliminated from the body. So these all can be calculated from this kinetic studies. So these kinetic studies can be calculated through some mathematical models, and that is studied in the case of compartment models. So in this compartment models, there are several types. The first one is about one compartment model. So this one compartment model is the simplest way to describe the process of drug distribution and elimination in the body. So this model assumes that the drug can enter or leave the body, that is open model, enter or leave in the body, and the entire body acts like a single uniform compartment. So that we call it as a one compartment model. And the next is about multi-compartment model. So multi-compartment model, in this we can say about two compartment model. So body is divided into two parts, that is central and peripheral compartment. The central compartment consists of blood, extravascular fluid and high perfused tissues such as lungs, liver, heart, etc., where the distribution of drug will be practically instantaneous. So the next compartment is about peripheral compartment. So the peripheral compartment, which we call it as a compartment 2, so this consists of tissue where the distribution of the drug will be slower. So here in multiple compartment, we will be identifying the concentration of drug in the central compartment, thereby we can able to calculate the volume of distributions, AUC, all the parameters, how much the drug is getting movement from the central compartment to the peripheral compartment, and what is the ratio of metabolites that reaches from peripheral compartment back to the central compartment. And here the elimination takes place from the central compartment, which is an irreversible phenomenon. The movement of drug from central compartment to peripheral compartment will be called as K12. K12 is nothing but the rate kinetics of movement of drug from compartment 1 to the compartment 2. And the movement of metabolites or waste products from the peripheral compartment to the central compartment will be denoted as K21. And the movement of waste product from the central compartment to outside the body will be called as KE. So this can be calculated from these parameters. And the next is about linear, non-linear pharmacokinetics. So saying about linear pharmacokinetic model, so this is the simplest first order kinetics, which introduced to describe the course of drug disposition and its action. So these linear models assume that the pharmacokinetic parameters of the drug would not change when different dose or multiple dose of drugs were given. So this is what about linear pharmacokinetics. So in similar to that, in a contrary manner, with some drugs, increasing the dose or chronic medication, that may cause a deviation from the linear pharmacokinetic profile which has been observed in the previous conditions. So with single low dose of the same drug, there might be some deviation in absorption, distribution, metabolism or elimination. So that deviation is occurred due to some doses. That can be called as the nonlinear pharmacokinetic, also as a dose dependent pharmacokinetics. So this is the topics or outline which we will be discussing in the pharmacokinetic part of this course. So now let's move on to the next slide, where we can discuss about the chapters of this. So as a part of describing the syllabus, the unit 1 has three major parts. The first is about introduction to biopharmaceutics. In this, we will be familiarizing about the what is biopharmaceutics and its application in dosage form design, dose calculation, dose assessment, as well as dosing interval. And the second thing which we discuss under this is absorption. So saying about absorption, this is a process of movement of drug from the site of administration to the systemic circulation, as said earlier. So in this, we will be discussing about the mechanism of drug absorption, such as active or passive transportation. So passive transportation is nothing but climbing down the hill. So it doesn't need any energy. So movement of drug from the stomach to the blood through a membrane, it proceeds through diffusion or osmosis without use of any energy. That is called as passive diffusion. Whereas in case of active transport, there is being an use of some energy, example ATP. So the drug moves from the stomach to the blood through the membrane by use of an energy, which is called as active transportation. And this active transportation have several types, such as facilitated diffusion, carrier mediated transportation, phagocytosis, all these things that we can discuss later while we are discussing the topics in this unit wise. And the next thing is about distribution. And in distribution, here we majorly discuss about the factors which influencing the distribution. So as said earlier, distribution is movement of drug from one compartment to another compartment, means from blood to the extravascular fluid. So here, what are the factors involved in it? The factors majorly involved are the tissue permeability of drugs, and the second is organ size and coefficient rate, the third is binding of drugs, and the last is miscellaneous. So in case of tissue permeability of drug, there are two things. One is physical chemical properties of the drug. So under the physical chemical properties, here the factors such as solubility, dissolution, particle size, effective surface area, polymerization, salting process, or is lipophilization, lipophilic nature, pKa, these has a major role. These roles in affecting the distribution, that we will be discussing under this topic. And the next important thing under the tissue permeability is about physiological barriers. So in the body, we have various barriers, such as simple capillary endothelial barrier, simple cell membrane barrier, blood brain barrier, cerebrospinal fluid barrier, placental barrier, blood testis barrier. So these all things, drug to cross these barriers, it varies from among each other. So a blood brain barrier varies in its physiological nature, varies in its transportation of drug. Similarly, placental barrier varies. All these barriers has its own individuality. So we will be discussing about what is the barrier is of, what is its physiological nature, and what type of drug can be permeated, and how the drug can make to be permeated through these membranes. These all aspects we will be discussing in this topic. And the next is about organ size and perfusion rate. As we discussed previously, in the central compartment, peripheral compartment in the kinetics topic. So a central compartment has nothing but high perfusion tissues, or organ which demands a large amount of blood supply, such as heart, lungs, or liver. So when these organs receive a large amount of blood, a large amount of drug will be reaching to these area, whereas the peripheral components will be using less percentage of blood, thereby less percentage of drug. So the distribution affects based upon the size of the organ as well as the perfusion rate, that we will be discussing in detail. The third one third factor which is involved is binding of drugs. So the drug bind to two components. One is the blood components, another is the extravascular tissue protein. So based upon the binding tendency, the drug circulation in the body enhances, means the half-life of the drug will be enhancing. So higher the binding capacity, higher the half-life will be there, therefore the drug. So this binding of drug to protein is a reversible process. So the binding, but based upon the binding efficiency, it may be for half an hour, or for some drugs it will be for an hour, for some drugs it will be for 2 days also. It depends. So the affinity differs from drug to drug with the protein. So that is another factor. And next is about the miscellaneous factor, which covers about age, diet, obesity, diseased condition or drug interactions. All these aspects will be discussed in the topics. Let's move on to the next slide or the next unit. So the unit 2 covers two topics. One is about elimination and another is about bioavailability. So before going to bioavailability, let us discuss about elimination. So elimination, as I said earlier, here it undergoes two processes. One is biotransformation, another is excretion of drug or elimination of drug. So in this, biotransformation is nothing but chemical changing of drug. So drug will change from one form to another chemical form. Particularly, the active drug will be converted into inactive metabolite. So that is waterborne. This is one part of biotransformation. In some condition, the active drug may be converted into a toxic substances. So in some case where the dose is higher, or when the drug is not compatible to the body, or drug interacts with the food, or drug interacts with some other drugs. So in such condition, there might be chances of developing a drug into a toxic molecule. So there is a chance. So due to the enzymatic action, it happens sometimes. So that is another condition where a biotransformation convert an active to a toxic material. And another case criteria about biotransformation is inactive to active, which can be called as a prodrug. So some drugs will be inactive if getting inactive, or it will be getting deteriorated if it is in the same active form. So in order to protect the drug, we will be converting it into an inactive prodrug nature. So this prodrug will be administered, and once it reaches the liver after absorption from the stomach, there it undergoes enzymatic action, and the prodrug will be getting converted to an active molecule. So this is one concept. And in some condition, the drug may be converted into another pharmacological activity. So by label claim, it will be having one pharmacological activity. Due to some enzymatic action, it within the body, it may be converted into some other chemical nature. Thereby, it elucidates some other unexpected pharmacological actions also. So these are some of the chances which is possible in the biotransformation. So in this biotransformation, so we will be discussing about the metabolism of drug. So here it undergoes two major processes. One is phase 1 and another is phase 2. So the phase 1 majorly proceeds with oxidation, reduction, hydrolysis process, and it can be also called as functionalization reaction. So this phase 1 is the first phase, and this precedes the phase 2. So continuing to it, the phase 2, it involves covalent attachment of small polar endogenous molecule such as glucuronic acid or sulfates will be converted into an unchanged drug, or the phase 1 products such as hydroxyl carboxylic acid will be getting converted into a highly water soluble molecules, so that it will be getting conjugated and it can be readily soluble and eliminated through kidney. So what are the drug, and how does the drug undergo phase 1 reaction and phase 2 reaction, and how does it convert into a metabolite, and how does it proceeds for elimination, that will be discussing in this topic. So in the case of elimination, the main organ involved is kidney, and the structural function of the kidney is a nephron. So we will be discussing about the parts of nephron, which you might be already studied in APH, anatomic physiology and health education. The glomerular filtration, tubular secretion, tubular reabsorption. So in these area, how does a drug get filtered or secrete, or it get reabsorbed, or what are the factors involved in affecting these causes of a drug, that we will be discussing. And followed by the concept of clearance. As we said previously, a drug can be eliminated in either by renal or by non-renal. So renal in the sense, the drug which is getting eliminated through kidney, whereas non-renal in the sense, a drug can be get eliminated either through saliva or from intestine or through sweat glands, or it can be eliminated through lungs, or sometimes it may be eliminated through bile secretions. So a drug which eliminated through these routes we call it as a non-renal excretion. So that's what we'll be discussing about this content in the elimination. So the second part of the syllabus of the unit is bioavailability and bioequivalence. So about bioavailability, here we'll be coming to know about what is absolute bioavailability, what is relative bioavailability. So in case of relative bioavailability, it is nothing but when a systemic availability of a drug after oral administration is compared with that of the oral administration of a standard of same drug. So that is called as a relative bioavailability, oral administration of test with the oral administration of a standard. So saying about absolute bioavailability, so when a systemic availability of a drug after oral administration is compared with that of the same drug of intravenous administration. So a comparison of oral administration with intravenous administration is nothing but a absolute bioavailability. And here we'll be identifying, coming to know about what is the bioavailability of a single dose or multiple dose, what will be the bioavailability change, and that we'll be knowing about it. And similarly, we'll be knowing the ideal factors which is involved in dissolution parameters. So in case of dissolution parameters, there are various types of dissolution apparatus, type 1 to type 7. So most of them are officially pharmacopoeically approved, and some are literaturely approved models which are using for dissolution apparatus. And these are dissolution apparatus vary based upon the dosage form what we are using. So for some dosage form we will be using USP type 1 apparatus, for some we will be using USP type 2, for some dosage form we will be using reciprocating cells, for some dosage form we will be using diffusion cells. So like this, for each dosage form the selection of dissolution apparatus varies. So that we will be discussing while during this unit. And continuing to it, the comparison of in vitro with an in vivo. So in vitro in vivo correlation, IVIVC. So this is nothing but identifying the similarities of drug release in the laboratory level when compared to that of the animal models. So how far it has been simulating, how far it has been simulated from the release of drug in the lab level to the animal model. Does the enzymes or the animal nature affects it or not, or does it obey with the in vitro condition? That will be coming to know by this in vitro in vivo correlation studies, and there are some significations and most important application by these studies. So that we will be discussing during this topic. And the next continuation to it is about the bioequivalence. So what is a bioequivalence? And this bioequivalence has a major role in current ANDA, that is abbreviated new drug delivery system, abbreviated new drug administration. So here a generic product, when it is have to be launched in market, they no need to perform a clinical trials or aspect. So thereby a large of production cost can be minimized. So a drug can be, drug cost also can be reduced by this. Means a person is going to launch his generic product, he can compare with the innovator by the in vitro dissolution conditions, and by proving its bioequivalence they can launch the product in the market. So thereby the cost of the dosage form may be reduced. So this is one important thing. So bio behavior, is an important thing which comes under the regulatory aspect, which is in the current UC also. And the last thing which we covers in the topic is about the bioavailability enhancement process. So, saying about bioavailability enhancement process, one important thing which is related to this is BCS classification. Hope you might be knowing what is BCS. So, BCS is nothing but Biopharmaceutical Classification System. So, in this, the drugs will be categorizing into any one of the classes. So, there are four classes: class 1, and class 2, class 3, class 4. So, these classes has been discriminated mainly by using two parameters. One is solubility, another is permeability. So, if a drug is having high solubility and high permeability, that will be coming under the class 1. And in class 2, a drug which is poor soluble but high permeable will be coming under the classification of class 2. And a drug which is having high solubility but poor permeability categorized under the class 3. And a drug which is having poor solubility and poor permeability will be categorized under the class 4. So, in case of class 2, class 3, class 4, either are problems, by using any one of the approach, we have to enhance the bioavailability. There are some methods which we are using, such as solid dispersion, solvent evaporation, eutectic powders, or use of some cyclodextrin, complexation, several processes are there. So, regarding the various methods which is available for enhancing the bioavailability, we will be discussing in this chapter. But the chapter 3. So, this chapter 3 mainly deals with the pharmacokinetics. So, here we will be coming to know about what is pharmacokinetics and what are the various pharmacokinetic models which are available to predict the various pharmacokinetic parameters such as AUC, Cmax, Tmax, Ke, T-half, all these parameters, mostly about compartment model, non-compartment model, physiological models, all these things. And in the same chapter, we will be continuing about one compartment open model where intravenous bolus administration, intravenous infusion, and extravascular administration we will be discussing, and how does these parameters such as Ke, T-half, volume of distribution, AUC, Ka, absorption constant, total clearance, renal clearance, all these will be calculating in the intravenous infusion, injection, as well as extravascular administration. These topics we will be discussing in the chapter. And in case of chapter 4, about multiple compartment model. So, similar to that of one compartment model, here in case of two compartment model, we will be discussing about the IV bolus administration. Nothing but as we said previously, central compartment and peripheral compartment. So, how does the movement of drug from the central compartment to peripheral compartment, and the movement of metabolites from the peripheral compartment to central compartment, and what is the elimination rate from the central compartment, Ke. So, these parameters will be calculated particularly for oral, for intravenous bolus administration open model. And similarly, the kinetics of multiple dosing. So, what are the various kinetics of multiple dosing? In repeat administration, what is the steady state level of drug which has been achieving? That we will be discussing. Also, we will be studying about the loading dose as well as maintenance dose. So, in case of loading dose and maintenance dose, so once we are administering a drug, so it reaches onset of action, and followed by it reaches a therapeutic activity, and the dose will be reaching to a particular range in the therapeutic level. So, once it reaches the maximum concentration, it may be chance to move to the elimination part. In order to maintain the drug in the same level, we will be administering a maintenance dose that it suitably reaches that concentration and maintain the concentration for longer duration, thereby the patient will be getting relief from the diseases. So, this particular thing, we will be going for a maintenance dose and what are the various clinical settings and what is the significance in it of administering the main loading dose and maintenance dose, these we will be calculating. So these particularly relates to the controlled release, sustained release parameters. And in the unit 5, nonlinear pharmacokinetic. So as we said, there are some causes of nonlinearity in absorption, distribution, metabolism and elimination. So what are the various causes and how does these occur? That we will be discussing in this nonlinear pharmacokinetics. Along with that, we will be computing this Km as well as Vmax by using Michaelis-Menten's equation. So Km is nothing but Michaelis constant, whereas Vmax is theoretical maximum rate of the process. So in some condition, the constant will be equal to the maximum rate of constant, Km is equal to Vmax, or in some cases Km will be greater than Vmax, or some condition Km will be less than Vmax. So what are the condition, how does it affect and how does it can be correlated with the non-linear pharmacokinetics and how does the parameters can be identified, that we will be discussing in this unit. So these are the various topics that which comes under the course Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics. So students, you might be got clear about the topics which is with the respective units that we are going to discuss in the upcoming classes in this course of Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics in this 6th semester. So students, before going to the next slide, let me conclude it that this Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics is one of the core aspect in pharmaceutical sciences in connection to industrial aspect, which majorly involves in all the areas in industries such as drug discovery, that is in F4MD, and in preclinical settings as well as in clinical trials, in post clinical surveillance, and in regulatory, as I said earlier, in biowaiver process of clinical trials, skipping the clinical trials in generic product launching, as well as in clinical pharmacokinetics, where the dose adjustment for every individual and diseased case such as a renal failure patient or liver disorder patient, where the dose has to be adjusted in the hospital for the patients, or in such conditions, this clinical pharmacokinetics, this biopharmaceutics plays a major role. And also in software area, particularly SAS programming, that we have this biopharmaceutical applications a lot in SAS programming. So these are all the opportunities where you can excel by using these biopharmaceutics and pharmacokinetics in the existing pharma areas. But the other thing, it is no full stop, it is still being continued. Also, this course will be a lead for tomorrow's research or else next generation therapeutics aspects such as personalized medicine and genetic polymorphism. So these all are interlinked with the with this course Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics. So hope you now you might got an idea about the importance of this chapter or these course Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics and its application in various sectors of pharma industries, and thereby I expect your attention towards this topic and make yourself familiarized to excel in your career path. But now let's move on to the next slide. So the reference textbook for this complete course, you can refer various textbooks. Let me list out a few of those. First is about Biopharmaceutics and Clinical Pharmacokinetics by Milo Gibaldi, and Biopharmaceutics and Clinical Pharmacokinetics by Robert E. Notari, and Applied Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics by Leon Schargel and Andrew, and Biopharmaceutics and Pharmacokinetics by Brahmankar and Sunil V. Jaiswal. So these are some of the reference textbooks which you can verify for related to your topics. which is covered in this course. Also, some other textbooks are available that you can get additional information which will be supporting you to appear in competitive national level competitive examinations. Also update yourself with various online sources, so thereby you can get aware about what are the current research happenings in related to the topics. Not only for this subject or this course, you can verify and update yourself by the online sources to the current technologies also. So this is what about the various sites. And my humble request, all of you, please stay home, please stay safe. So save your lives and save world. Hope you have got a clear idea about these topics, and in case of any doubts, please feel free to contact back, or you're welcome with your questions so that we can go over it. And in the upcoming slides or upcoming of my presentations, we can discuss all these chapters one by one in details. Expecting your extended cooperation and attention towards the topic. Thank you all. Thank you for your valuable time.